Hello, I'm Shelley Broderick, Dean of the UDC David A. Clark School of Law and your host for Sound Advice. Synthetic drugs have emerged in recent months as a significant challenge for law enforcement, prosecutors, and communities here in the district as well as nationwide. For instance, the average number of monthly calls that the district's emergency medical personnel take for patients on synthetic drugs spiked from fewer than 50 per month last year to more than 600 per month in recent months. With me today to talk about this important matter are Karl A. Racine, the first elected Attorney General of the District of Columbia, who's been focusing on fighting synthetic drugs as one of his priorities, and Michael Wes Aniton, an Assistant Attorney General in the office's Neighborhood and Victim Services section. He and his colleagues work to fight neighborhood problems like synthetic drugs. Welcome.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Well, I'm delighted to have you both. Karl and I, we go way back. It's a family affair.
Absolutely.
His mom and I are old buddies. She's a longtime legendary professor here at UDC.
Excellent.
I just saw her the other day. She's amazing. And I loved watching your campaign and successful election as the very first elected Attorney General for the District of Columbia. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Shelley. And we certainly campaigned hard. As you remember, there were four other candidates, excellent people.
He liked his colleague. He liked his rivals a little too much.
He
would tear. You know, he was like, "Yeah, good answer." I'm like, "No, don't answer."
Well, you know, I wasn't born a politician, nor do I ever want to act like a politician all the time.
Good news.
So, no, we had a competitive race, and certainly very happy to have won. And the first 10 months of office has been an exhilarating experience.
A lot of hard work.
No doubt about it.
I mean, you know, it's a huge portfolio.
It's a huge portfolio, and let me just say that the 600 staff that we have, about 300 lawyers, about 300 non-professionals, these are public servants who are not making an extraordinary amount of money.
Yes,
who come into work every single day and work their butts off in order to do good for D.C. residents. So I'd like to give a big shout out to the Office of Attorney General staff.
Well, I'm so glad you did that. You know, that office took it in the neck publicly for a long time. You know, it was well known that they just were totally under-resourced forever in horrible space. Insufficient computers.
That's
even.
Right.
Just no supplies. It was awful in the bad old days. And the office has benefited from some very strong leadership.
Indeed.
It's just thrilling to feel like, you know, you're a guy, you were managing partner at Venable, one of the best law firms, the biggest law firms in the country. I think you were responsible for something like $600 million bottom line every year. You're up to the task. You know, you're not just some guy, oh, that sounds like a cool job. No, you know, you're a DC guy who gets it decided to take this on. So as a citizen and a resident, I'm very, very, very proud of you and delighted to have you driving.
Well, as I said, it's an honor to serve every day, and there's nothing more important than having a positive impact on people's lives. And clearly the issue that we're going to talk about today, this scourge of synthetic cannabinoids, is something that is causing great havoc in the District of Columbia.
Well, you know, I really want to hear a little bit more about it. I have a 23-year-old daughter who went through DC public schools, and I certainly saw and heard about drug use in DC, like everywhere else around the country. There's a lot of drug use, but this is terrifying. Just hearing 600 calls a month with people, and they don't call because, oh, I'm having a good time, this drug is terrific,
right.
I feel great. That's not why they call. They call when they're having serious, horrible health effects and impacts that can lead to mental health impacts. How did you get into this area?
Yes, well, I'm in the Neighborhood and Victim Services section. And just to say, we are pleased to have Attorney General Racine in the office now. He has given our section great support in dealing with neighborhood issues, specifically synthetic drugs. There are many different types of synthetic drugs. Synthetic cannabinoids happen to be the synthetic drug that is plaguing DC at the moment. And MPD, the Metropolitan Police Department, they brought this issue to our office and worked very closely with us to address the issue. Synthetic cannabinoids essentially are chemicals that are sprayed on dry plant material. And these,
like by plant material, you mean like tobacco?
Can be tobacco, can be potpourri.
Okay.
Anything that can be rolled into a joint.
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely.
To use the technical term.
Yes.
Like Hillary Clinton, I'm a child of the 60s.
You and me both.
Yes, yes.
But that's another story, and the statute of limitations has run.
Has run, right. So yes, these dangerous chemicals are sprayed on these on this plant material, and they're packaged, and each individual package, we don't know how much concentration of these dangerous drugs are in each package. So the effects...
You have no idea what you're getting into when you try.
Exactly, you have no idea.
So I remember the first time I ever heard about these, I was hearing about them in the context of you can smoke this and it won't show up in a drug test. And so people were talking about, oh, finally we've beat the system. You can get away with this. You know, you can't smoke marijuana because that'll show up in a drug test, but you can do this. Is that correct?
No, that is absolutely not correct. The today, pretrial services, they actually can and do test for synthetic cannabinoids or these synthetic drugs.
So hopefully that's a deterrent. If people hear that, it's like, okay, I'm going to get busted for that.
Absolutely.
I'm going to flunk a drug test.
But, and that's why it's so important, and Wes's team is doing a great job in getting the word out that myth number one,
right,
you can smoke this synthetic stuff and it's never going to show up in your system. You're going to be okay. Well, that is a myth. It's not true. We're now testing for it. You will be found out, and there will be consequences.
That's so important.
No Absolutely. Doubt about
and
it.
And myth number two is it's like marijuana.
Right. That is a terrible myth. It was initially marketed as the alternative, the safe alternative to marijuana, but indeed it is extremely dangerous, far more dangerous than marijuana. As you were alluding to earlier, the effects can be seizures, hallucinations, strokes. The dangers run the gambit of health issues.
And I would note that there is also a direct correlation to violent psychotic reactions. Oftentimes, our first responders, those folks in the EMS ambulances who come out and tend to victims, are confronted with a very violent and aggressive individual who is overdosed.
So it's like a PCP.
It's a lot like a PCP, but candidly, what folks tell us, including people who have used the drug, is that this is a drug they've never seen before in terms of its unpredictability.
Right.
And that's why we have to be so vigilant. Shelley, just last week, the Office of the Medical Examiner here in the District of Columbia identified three cases of individuals who died as a result of synthetic cannabinoid overdose. So
wow.
This is not marijuana.
And so I have been reading terrifying stories about the rise in heroin use.
Yes.
You know, that in my generation was, you know, like, really? A junkie? You would put a needle in your body? And everywhere I go across the country, I read story after story after story about the gigantic increase. Are we seeing that in the District of Columbia, or is this cannabinoid just way more prevalent?
You're asking an excellent question. And so we have seen an increase in the use of heroin. We've seen a slight increase in the overdoses of heroin, but they pale in comparison in the District of Columbia to what we're seeing on the synthetic cannabinoid level. For example, you talked about emergency services calls. Last month, we had only two heroin calls, right? Contrast that with the 600 calls that we had in September. So there's a stark difference in usage in the District of Columbia.
And where do you buy it?
And that's where I was just about to go. Thank you for that transition. That's probably one of the problems here is that over the past year, past several months, These synthetic drugs have been available in convenience stores, in gas stations.
You can buy it in a store or a gas station.
Exactly. Well, until the Attorney General's office stepped in and really started shutting these stores down, and I will get to that. We will get to that in a moment. But it was very easy to obtain these synthetic drugs in the convenience stores and in the corner stores, and they were marketed to children. You know, they're packaged and they're called
teens.
Scooby snacks. Teens, young adults. They're entitled Scooby snacks or Bizarro, and the packages are brightly colored. You know, these types of
comic
things exaggerate. They appeal to young people, and they were marketed as not for human consumption. So the right.
Who would want that?
Right.
So, not for human consumption.
Right. And the manufacturers were doing that because they knew that these synthetics weren't being regulated as an item for human consumption. So that's why it was easy at first. But once the Metropolitan Police Department alerted our office to it, we took great and diligent steps to address the issue.
Is it a narcotic?
It is.
It's on a schedule, so
yes.
It's a very good question you ask. It is indeed on a schedule. Here's the problem. The problem is that because we're talking about synthetic compounds, the bad guys are always a step ahead of the good guys, the sheriff. So they can easily change the compound nature with really just a wand of the hand and then try to escape liability in that regard. So I can tell you, we're working on legislation that will allow us to have greater prosecutorial tools by going after the class of compounds, not just the specific compound itself. And so we'll be submitting that legislation to the council in short order.
It's so terrifying. I was in China last year, and I heard an amazing lecture about Big Pharma and the differences between China and the U.S. And they actually executed the head of their equivalent of the Federal Drug Administration because he had approved over 10,000 requests for drug approvals in 1 year. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it was totally corrupt system. He was executed, and now they're trying to crack down on the unregulated drugs. So here we're getting these drugs, and they're shifting the makeup. Well, you know they're not getting FDA regulated,
no,
because that takes
not.
Years of testing.
Yes.
And so what you're saying is they're kind of on the fly changing the compound.
Yes.
And so any consumer, and by that I mean literally a consumer, is an idiot if you're taking that risk, given what we're hearing.
Right, because we truly don't know, like we were talking about earlier, what is in each package and how much of a concentration is in each package.
So how are you going about enforcement? These businesses that were selling them?
Sure.
Are they still selling them?
So here's what we've done and what
okay.
we continue to do. Working very closely with the Metropolitan Police Department, we identify stores that have a record of selling this stuff. We'll go in and do an investigation. Oftentimes it's videotaped. And once we gather the facts and the evidence
that they're selling it to kids?
That they're selling the drugs, period, because the drugs are illegal. Now, they'll claim that they're selling it, and they know they're selling it with the intent that it not be consumed by human beings.
I see.
But that's
the trick
a fallacy.
Is, it
right?
says
everybody
right on there.
Knows that
right.
these things are being smoked, and everybody knows the havoc that they're causing. So what we do is we go in with the MPD, and then we use the civil nuisance statutes to go about alleging a nuisance and shutting the businesses down.
Wow.
We've done that on several occasions. We have several investigations that we're working on now. And of course, with every shutdown, we promote this to make sure that all of the other convenience stores know that there's a new game in town now. You cannot engage in the sales. We've had a very good reaction, I should note, from responsible convenience store owners. In fact, a Korean convenience store association has agreed to join the Office of Attorney General's enforcement efforts. We're educating their community and otherwise getting the word out that it's not good business to be in the business of peddling harmful drugs to
young
people.
You can get shut down, and by the way, it's also a product that can have very serious life-threatening or taking.
Right.
consequences.
That's exactly right.
And to to add to what Mr. Racine has just said is not only are our responsible convenience stores and corner store owners taking note of this and making sure that their stores and their employees aren't involved in this, in the sale of these synthetic drugs, but the communities themselves are extremely happy that, that our office is engaging in this this enforcement. Specifically, one of the stores on 800 Upshur Street Northwest, the community, their response to our efforts has been extraordinary, and they are exceedingly pleased that that store, it was a market, has now been evicted, and they're going to have a new law-abiding establishment moving in.
Well, I'm so glad you're diving into this and working on it. You know, look, I was a child of the 60s, as may have been mentioned, and there was certainly plenty of experimentation that I may or may not have witnessed.
Right.
Off the record.
in my youth. And there's a lot of danger associated with this. And seeing these kids come along, you know, they're risk takers.
Right. That's right. Well, and that's why, look, part of the process has to be about enforcement. And of course, we're doing that. But it's fundamentally also must be about education. And that's why we spend a lot of time and energy, particularly over the summer, still doing it now, going out to the schools, going out to the homeless shelters, and informing folks that those two myths, it's only marijuana, it's never going to appear in my system, are not true. Moreover, as we now know, unfortunately, from the medical examiner, this stuff can kill you.
If it's not sold in convenience stores, is this sold hand to hand on the street, or how else?
Yes, that is one of the concerns, is that now that we've increased the enforcement on the convenience stores and on the corner markets, that the sellers of these dangerous synthetics are now selling them on the street, and what the Metropolitan Police Department terms loosies. They'll sell them in individually rolled cigarettes on the street. But while that may be the case, the Metropolitan Police Department is extremely diligent. They communicate with us on a regular basis, and they are also enforcing the street level sales of the synthetic drugs.
I should note also that here we've been able to partner quite well with our colleagues in the DC government. The DC Department of Regulatory Affairs also has a say in businesses who get licenses. They've been extremely diligent in following up with us and pulling licenses. That's really important. We've also partnered with the DEA to enhance testing, and thirdly, with the United States Attorney's Office to make sure that it's a priority of that office to go after the dealers.
So who's making these drugs? Where is all this coming from?
So they are primarily manufactured in China. Unfortunately, a lot of times the manufacturers of these synthetic drugs don't know that they're actually making these compounds that are going to be used for human consumption later on. Because these factories over there, they'll make drugs and compounds for a variety of reasons, a variety of legal reasons. So that's the first level manufacturer. They don't even know sometimes that they're making these drugs that are going to, or these chemicals that are going to be used.
What else would it be used
later.
For? Do you know?
They manufacture chemicals for glues, all sorts of just basic manufacturing needs.
Okay.
A lot of times they're not informed of that. The lower level manufacturers are not informed of that.
Gotcha.
But they are made over in China primarily, and then they're shipped here internationally, and they come in a lot of times through California, and they're dispersed through there. Just recently, the Metropolitan Police Department made a very big seizure of synthetic drugs that were coming into the district.
That's right, and we're also seeing from our federal partners and talking to them regularly an increase in manufacturing and exportation from Mexico as well.
The cartels?
That's right. I mean, the bottom line is where you have an eager consumer, the cartels and others will get product to that consumer.
Yep, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Are other cities seeing the same kind of level of increase?
Yes, indeed. There have been any number of articles throughout the year focused on abuse of synthetic drugs. Big problem up in Syracuse, New York. We were just up in New York City for a conference on emerging drug trends, and we focused our efforts on both heroin and synthetics. So this is not just a local DC problem. This is a problem because the drug is cheap. The drug will definitely mess up your brain. For better or for worse, unfortunately, we have a lot of people in the United States who are looking to escape from reality.
I was listening to a song on the radio, and you know, my head jerked up as the lyric is, "Needle in my bed, going to wind up dead." You know, this, you know, you think you get past a devastating era of heroin use, and from what I understand from the newspaper, people were doing ecstasy and all of the rave kinds of party drugs, and they have become, because of law enforcement in part, so prohibitively expensive to get now that kids are turning to heroin.
Yeah, well, the heroin issue itself is a complex issue. The best studies that I've read, and certainly when we were in New York with our state AG colleagues, what the data is showing is that the principal problem is the overprescription of painkillers. Once folks are on painkillers and become addicted to that, they're going to need to have that relief, okay? There comes a point where the prescription drugs are no longer available or become too expensive. And that's where heroin comes into play. And so in order to really—
It has the same properties.
It has the same properties, and the brain doesn't distinguish between a prescription painkiller and heroin. And heroin is a lot cheaper than the prescription drugs. And so any attempt to fix the problem must start off with our oversubscription of painkillers. A great article just in yesterday's newspaper written by Johns Hopkins University professors calling for greater restraint on the part of our medical professionals in writing prescriptions.
Well, that's a huge problem. I mean, you really hear these kids all seem to have these painkiller prescriptions.
Yes.
Along with the, you know, I mean, the Xanax and the Ambien and the, it's just all the time. You
right.
see it and you hear about it all the time.
And an additional concern is the mixing of these synthetic drugs and the prescription drugs. I mean, that's one of the other issues, is if you take one and then you take another, or you
it's
mix
like
it with
booster.
Alcohol. It's exactly, it's a cocktail of drugs, and that is another concern.
We have about 5 more minutes. I want to give you a chance to say more things about this or other subjects that the office or your field office are undertaking.
Sure. What I'd like to talk about just for a moment is the work that we're doing in the area of juvenile justice. I know how much you're concerned about that. Let me focus on a couple of points. First, when I came into office, the unfortunate practice of shackling any juvenile who came into the courts was ongoing.
Just outrageous.
I got to tell you, what we did when we came into office is we got a list of what we thought responsible stakeholders, including Chief Judge Satterfield of the Superior Court, Kenyon McDuffie at the council, and we got together and we talked about the issues related to mandatory shackling. And I have to credit Judge Satterfield for being open-minded enough to turn away from the blanket rule of shackling. And so kids now in the District of Columbia are not being automatically shackled. They're getting an individualized screening, see whether they're a danger to themselves or anybody else in the courtroom. And if they're not, they're being treated as they should,
like
humanely.
Kids.
Exactly, that's number one. Number two, in the area of criminal justice, as you well know, Shelley, the record is clear. When we bring kids into the criminal justice system, and to be sure, kids who are violent, who are playing around with guns and are threatening folks with guns, should in fact be separated from society. But the overwhelming majority of kids who enter a criminal justice system are not those kids. When we bring those kinds of kids into the criminal justice system, they tend to learn bad behavior, and when they get out, continue to commit crimes. What we focused on, therefore, is diverting kids away from the criminal justice system. And what we found in diverting a lot of kids away from the criminal justice system is that 87% of those kids have not been rearrested. And so providing services in the community, getting the family involved, having strict curfew, discipline, substance abuse and mental abuse therapies were indicated is working for our kids.
You know, I'll tell you, I was in Philadelphia watching Edgar Khan be honored a few weeks ago with the United States Attorney for the district involving Philadelphia and the president of the bar and you know, a couple of hundred people in a very fancy dinner honoring him for a youth court where the kids basically sentence each other. These kids have run across, you know, gotten into trouble, and as a diversionary mechanism, these kids have youth court and they go through court by their peers. And
that's
their
right.
peers are a lot tougher than us white liberals, you know, and other liberals.
Sure.
And they, you know, take these kids to task and sentence them to community service and to doing things that will help put them on the right track.
That's right.
That's had a huge impact on reducing recidivism. Also, I want to encourage you guys to
Indeed.
Look back into that.
And that's I should tell you that right now we're piloting an effort at Ballou High School where we have our lawyers and the folks, good folks at Ballou, working with a leadership group of kids to do just that.
I should
resolve
hope so, because 1,500 kids were kicked out of Ballou in 1 year. 1,500 kids suspended. Are
right.
you kidding me? How can that be good? I don't know about you, but if I missed a month of high school, I wouldn't have gone.
Game over.
Synthetic drugs are an important topic, and if you want to know more about them and how to fight them, the Office of the Attorney General offers several resources. You can call them at 202-727-3400 or visit the Office of the Attorney General's website at oag.dc.gov. I'm Shelley Broderick. Thanks for watching, and please join me next time for more sound advice.